It's a bright, beautiful day at Camp Chaos. A weekend of camping and celebration of friendship is underway. Friends have gathered, as we have gathered, on this very spot for the past 20 years. We've assembled around the Great Stump once again to participate in the opening ceremonies of the 20th annual Scottishfest Games. And, as tradition has dictated, on the last Saturday of September, rain or shine, we will hold our own private Highland Games competition. But first, a little backstory would be helpful. For the seeds of this event were sown long ago. Scottishfest didn't just emerge from the ether. It's an event that combines the loves, interests, and passions of its collective. Music, camping, revelry, camaraderie have been percolating around this group from its infancy. It's a story of young dreamers who forged friendships most only wish for. The majority in our tale have been together for over 30 years, a diverse and multi-talented group of individuals who created their own private realm when the one they desired didn't exist. Along the way, they found one of the most important aspects of life. They found love and companionship. They found their tribe. And that, right there, is the story. The story of our tribe. So, set your chair up by the fire. I'll pour you one. Smoke what you like, because we don't judge. And welcome. Our tale begins way back in the mid-1990s, serendipitously amongst the backdrop of the Bristol Renaissance Fair. A few of us worked the fair, and we were all regulars with full, proud, and stunningly geeked out attire. It's through that setting that a fellowship of sorts began to take shape. A couple times a summer, the core group would spend the day together at the fair, cavorting at Wench Cathy's, buying cool shit, and getting pretty deep in the cups along the way. Typically, we'd participate in the closing drum jam, then continue with an after-fair party and cookout at one of the houses, lasting until the early hours of the following day. Over time, other like-minded and eclectic friends of these friends found their paths converging together as well. As our group grew, we started creating our own unique gatherings. First and foremost, music always found its way into our gatherings. Countless evenings were spent gorging ourselves on our own live music for our own enjoyment. Like this group itself, everyone's musical contributions varied widely. Rotating instruments, we jammed everything from the Beatles to Limp Bizkit. Many in our fold play and love music. It's a deep, shared joy we collectively possess to this day. The music was almost always present. It was just something we did. We'd hang and jam, and then hang some more. We also held some damn fine parties. We toasted our circle and celebrated our friendships. The positive energy of any one of our events was indescribable. The vibe was always awesome. And we did some really cool shit. We felt like gods. Fantasy, history, the arts, higher expressions of thought, and comedic nirvana. And to be sure, ever present in this early history was a mutual love of all things Scottish and Scotch. there was a recurring midwinter feast called the Every Man's Home is His Castle Party. Dressed in our Wren attire, we dined on a plethora of home-cooked delights, mostly chosen to fall within the criteria of being able to be eaten with your fingers. Throughout this evening, a ruckus, smoke-filled basement pub called The Keep was the hub of activity, music, dancing, and revelry. In groups of two, we slipped away to a secret room to recite an ancient toast. We knelt before a small chest emblazoned with a green, glowing-eyed serpent. A creak of the lid revealed a leather-bound bottle containing the Sangre de Dragos, or the Blood of the Dragon in the common tongue. Before we drink, we'd recite an ancient toast, honoring those ancestors whose blood was spilled by the dragon. And then to Huma, the Dragon Slayer. And as a show of respect, we would toast the might and majesty of the dragon itself. Fulfilling this task earns you the Mark of the Dragon, identifying you as an officially initiated brethren. For some, seeing who could last the longest with the most dragon marks became a bit of a, shall we say, a gentleman's challenge. Moving on. There was our annual DSO, a kilted Scottish golf outing. It was a standard round, 9 holes of golf in kilts, plus the shot rule. The shot rule was simple. Each player carried their own flask of scotch. If one chose, at any point, one could subtract one stroke from their score by taking a single small swig of scotch. This act simultaneously lowered your score and exponentially increased the decibels of gaudy Scottish accents. I myself won the first 2 years with scores of 14 and 18. At any given outdoor activity, we enthusiastically, not at all skillfully, experimented with swordplay, using bamboo practice dojo shinai stick swords. Non-lethal, but damn fun to test our best Star Wars and Lord of the Rings hero moments. By now, it should be clear of our fondness for drink. This relationship eventually led us to the desire to create our own spirits. We started creating our own beer and mead. Inspired by our gatherings, we named our creations Kindred Spirits. Once we got our feet wet, we'd regularly brew 2 or 3 batches of beer to be dispensed on tap at our larger events. Along with the beer, a bottle or 3 of our mead would come out. Additional glassware was never required, though. Just pass the bottle through the affair, and don't set it down till it's empty. We also explored together. 2 trips to the UK, particularly Scotland, of course. Traveling by train and backpack and staying in hostels, we toasted and got toasty in centuries-old pubs. One even returned with a pint of water retrieved from the historic Chalice Well at the foot of Glastonbury Tor. Others congealed around week-long canoe trips to the Boundary Waters. Cut off from the outside world, deep in the wilderness, we relied on each other to complete our physical and mental journeys. The point I'm trying to make is that the raw ingredients and manifestations of Scottishfest have been present within this group from its infancy. Coupled with friendship of the deepest roots, something magical seemed destined to happen. Now, Running parallel during these years, for those employed as the Queen's Guard at the fair, the wearing of kilts or tartans of any kind was strictly forbidden. This is mainly due to the time period around which the fair is based on, 16th century England. During much of that period, kilts were outlawed. So in protest, during off hours, they would return to the fair as commoners and patrons. But instead of adhering to the Queen's policies, they would proudly wear their kilts. And life was good. But over time, as much as we adored the Ren Fair, it did prove to have one glaring flaw. Specifically, too many normal people walking around in mass ruining the vibe and our buzz. And so, the desire to create our own private Ren Fair-esque retreat began. A close family member of the group owned about 40 acres of remote land in Winneconnie, Wisconsin. Family owned, its main function is that of a tree farm. Hidden from the outside world, except for a worn dirt path driveway that disappears back into the trees. Initially, the blueprint was simple. A weekend of camping on the tree farm, where kilts would be worn, copious amounts of libations consumed, and Highland games played. Looking back, and loosely paraphrasing Thoreau, I believe it's clear we went to the woods to live deliberately. To suck the marrow out of life. The year was 1999. We pitched a couple of tents in the middle of the property and gathered under an enormous old oak tree. The very same oak tree that has become the central hub and shade of the competition today. As mentioned, it was only being used as a tree farm. No electricity, water, or structures. Just a crude outhouse, rows upon rows of young pine trees and tall grass. Off the beaten path it was. We were free to dance under the stars without a care of spectators or judgment. We had a caber and rock toss competition, a team game of capture the scotch, and some sword fighting. But that first weekend excursion was just the beginning. As the years passed, the site, the people, and the gathering changed and grew. Eventually, the talents and resources of many were used to clear land, construct a grand fire pit, and a genuine log shelter. And through this evolution, a meticulously crafted Scottish clan tournament was created. The place where all this takes place has come to be known as Camp Chaos. Our symbol, the arrows of chaos, signifying all directions, all possibilities. Now, back to fall 2019. In the weeks leading up to the event, monarchs are chosen. Participants vie for the title of king or queen to lead one of the three ancient clans, MacDougall, Stuart, and Balmoral. The bagpipes break up the contented morning conversation and we all begin to assemble. Before the event begins, the elected choose their clansmen and women. Clans don banners in their respective tartan colors. Group photos preserve the teams for posterity. As tradition now dictates, we gather before our eloquent crier, perched upon the grand stump. His familiar accented voice echoes through the camp. With poetic bluster, he brings all in attendance together, regaling tales of unsettled scores and bitter clan rivalries of years past. Gauntlets are thrown down, challenges are accepted, and with a shot from Stinky Dina, another year of Scottishfest begins. The clans commence the competition, an amalgam of physical and mental dexterity, traditional caber and rock toss. Rounds of single and group archery, classic horseshoes. Quarto, a deceptively simple two-player strategy board game, a perfect blend of chess and tic-tac-toe, played in a fraction of the time as a chess game, but just as infuriating. There's also Chennai sword fighting, golf pitching contest, and the dreaded tug of war. Strict rules are adhered to, scores are kept and tallied. Thick Scottish trash talk peppers the afternoon, mugs clink, and tense competition builds. Now, don't get me wrong, it's not all competition and no fun. For mixed into this 5 or 6 hour event is a joyous celebration of friendships spanning decades. On through the afternoon as the games are waged, a non-stop cacophony of laughter fills the air. Layers of apricot wit, the occasional patty nutty, but mostly unfettered brouhaha. Eventually, as the day's shadows lengthen, wounds are earned, feats celebrated, and victors emerge. But in the end, there can only be one winner, and only to those victorious can go the spoils. Another king and clan are proclaimed victorious and enshrined to their place in Camp Chaos history. But this day is far from over. The sky shifts from blue to orange and violet as the sun sets over Camp Chaos. A joyful din of shared camaraderie is heard around the camp, echoing up the hill. We share food, stories, back rubs, and anti-inflammatories as we catch up on each other's lives. Lives we've watched find love, have kids, start businesses, create art of all imaginable palettes. We have been devastated and heartbroken. We've fallen down, we've gotten back up, we've triumphed, we've failed. And through all that, through that passage of time, we've always found a way to come back to those who've always been there when we've needed them. We laugh, we cry, we exist.
There's creatures that live in the hole.
We do so uninhibited and unafraid because it is with each other that we feel safe and loved. The collective becomes one under the stars, the cup of our soul overflows. As we reflect back on the hundreds of smiles throughout the day, we find ourselves reflecting back on the years. It started with fun, and fun has always been present, but comfort and deep familial love has evolved around that fun. It has grown to something beyond mere friendship. A palpable sense of belonging is generated. Stress floats upwards and away like a thousand fire embers towards the night sky. Whatever baggage the world has thrust on you, it's for at least the moment forgotten. The arrows of chaos point in all directions except stress. Such things are not to be found within Camp Chaos. We experience pure joy. Spirit is awake and aware. Evident in these gatherings is the catalyst for understanding, possibility, and potential. It is within this realm kindred spirits are celebrated. The sunrise on Sunday initiates the inevitable, and the process of reacclimating back to reality begins. It's time to relinquish Camp Chaos back to the woods for another year. But first, the steam from a fresh cup of camp coffee lazily rises in the sharp morning rays and dew. Bloody Marys, breakfast burritos, and Yak Mein soup help soften the realization that it will be another 365 days before all will meet like this again. As tents are pulled and vehicles packed, we reminisce, not just about the beauty of the event, but about the beauty of the souls that gather here year after year. Laughter, love, and light have filled these souls and fueled us once again. Love is our mortar, and our mortar has been reinforced. As we slowly filter out of camp, we pass and reflect at the ruined rock. Liberties were taken with transcription and creation, but as far as we're concerned, it says what Camp Chaos is, and hopefully will be for a very long time. Not for you, not for me, but for us, and we are grateful.
One more time!
Does he know it's always